ਸਤਿ ਸ੍ਰੀ ਅਕਾਲ ਬਸ ਜੀ
ਸਤਿ ਸ੍ਰੀ ਅਕਾਲ ਸਤ ਜੀ
ਹਾਉ ਆਰ ਯੂ ਟੁਡੇ
ਆਮ ਡੂਇੰਗ ਗ੍ਰੇਟ
ਓ ਸੀਮਸ ਦੈਟ ਯੂ ਵੈਂਟ ਹੋਮ ਨੋ
ਯੈਸ
ਨਾਓ ਯੂ ਗਾਟ ਨਿਊ ਸ਼ਰਟ
ਨਿਊ ਸ਼ਰਟ ਬਟ ਯੂ ਨੋ ਯੂ ਆਰ ਆਲਵੇਸ ਓਪਨਿੰਗ ਦਿਸ ਪ੍ਰੋਗਰਾਮ ਨਾਓ ਯੂ ਸੈਡ ਸਤ ਸ੍ਰੀ ਅਕਾਲ ਨਾਓ ਵੀ ਆਰ ਗੋਇੰਗ ਟੂ ਗੈਟ ਲੈਟਰਸ
ਓ ਵਾਟ ਇਜ਼ ਸਤ ਸ੍ਰੀ ਅਕਾਲ
ਵਾਟ ਇਜ਼ ਸਤ ਸ੍ਰੀ ਅਕਾਲ
ਵਾਈ ਡੋਨਟ ਯੂ ਐਕਸਪਲੇਨ ਵਾਟ ਇਜ਼ ਸਤ ਸ੍ਰੀ ਅਕਾਲ
ਸਤ ਸ੍ਰੀ ਅਕਾਲ ਇਜ਼ ਅ ਗ੍ਰੀਟਿੰਗ ਆਈ ਐਮ ਫਰੋਮ ਪੰਜਾਬ
ਓਕੇ
In the northern Punjab is in the northern part of India. Mm. Born and raised there. I mean, born there, but not raised there. Mm. In our culture, when we meet each other and we greet each other, we say Sat Sri Akal. Mm. Just like in the Indian culture also, if you are a Hindu and you speak Hindi, they say Namaste. Mm. So, Sat Sri Akal is a greeting.
From Punjabi
greeting. Punjabi greeting.
Just like we say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord,
like
yes.
That. Okay. Yes. So, what's up? Did your wife say anything to you when you came home? You went home late yesterday?
No. I was on time. You After I left here, I went straight home.
So, was she surprised?
Yes.
Oh, my.
She said, what happened? You're home early.
She didn't cook dinner.
No.
Because you came home early, no?
Yes. So, we had to order a pizza.
Look at that.
You know. Mm. So, she was happy I came home.
Acha Pastor Ji, so yesterday you were sharing about, talking about this pride and all that.
Yes.
I'm sure when you went back home last night, you must have meditated further upon it. And did God show you anything else?
You know, He showed me an encounter that I had. Mm. You know, when I was in Chennai about a year and a half ago, and I was filming my program, Gateway to Heaven. Mm. One afternoon, the interpreter had to leave early, so we had to cut short. And you asked me, you said, when I came to the office, you said, what are you going to do now? And I said, I don't know. You said, you have a choice. You can hang around with me, or you can go to the hotel.
Okay.
So when I asked you, I said, okay, I'll hang around with you. You said, I have some meetings, I have to talk to some staff. Mm. So I decided I would go to the hotel. Mm. Not that I didn't want to hang around with you,
sure.
But you had to take care of business, so I thought it'd be easier. So I went to my hotel room. I was sitting, pondering, just relaxing. I had made myself a cup of tea. Mm. And I put worship on. Mm. And as I was worshiping, I was sitting on the chair, just sitting in my room and just... All of a sudden, a tall, big, giant being, about 8 foot tall, walked into my room. I looked at this being and I thought, something is just not, you know, clicking. Mm. Because most of the time I have experienced in my own experiences that I've had, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, that when things come from heaven, there's a certain presence. Mm. That comes with them. You know, when an angel comes into your room, even though you don't see it, you feel the presence, you know something is in the room. So this being was dressed perfectly, not even a wrinkle on his clothes, just beautifully dressed. Mm. The material on his suit, I have never seen before. Mm. I mean, it was shiny, but not shiny. It was silky, but it wasn't silky. It was like it wasn't of this world. Mm. And he had rings on his fingers, big, nice 2-3 watches. Mm. And he stood there and I said, who are you? And he looked at me, he says, I have made myself. Mm. If you will follow me, you can be like me. Mm. I said, okay. I felt something stirring in my heart, you know. And I said, wow. I said, it's not from the kingdom of God, you know. So I closed my eyes and I just continued to worship the Lord. Mm. And when I opened my eyes, He was gone. Mm. So I got on my knees. I said, I need to know. So I said, Lord, please tell me, what was this? Mm. Because He repeated a couple of things. You know, He said, I am a self-made man.
Oh.
I have made myself. Nobody has helped me. Mm. So when I asked the Lord said, that was pride. Mm. And He said this, that's what broke my heart. Mm. He said, it is this spirit that is keeping me from operating in my own church. Mm. So I was pondering on that yesterday after I left you, that when he said these words, it is this spirit that is hindering me to operate in my own church. So what that tells me is that the Lord would desire to come within his church, but because of this spirit, he cannot even come into his own house.
So that reminds me of one thing, you know. If you look at the scriptures in Matthew 21, when the Lord Jesus Christ came to Jerusalem, you know, there was a big fanfare when he came in.
Yes.
Everybody was so excited.
Yes.
They came in. As soon as he entered into the city, there was a big welcoming party.
Yes.
You know, and he received it with great joy because people were, they thought, finally the Messiah had come.
Right.
Which is right, but their mind was wrong. So the Lord came in, he went straight to the temple. When he entered the temple, it says, Matthew 21, verse 12, and Jesus went into the temple of God and cast out all them that sold and bought in the temple and overthrew the tables of the money changers and the seats of them that sold doves and said unto them, it is written, my house shall be called the house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves. Commercialization of the works of God.
Works of God, yes.
You know, Pastor G, if you look at the scripture, there's something strange here. And Jesus went into the temple of God.
Yes.
Now, please, I don't know whether you have your pen with you or not.
Yes, I do.
If you do, please kindly, if you don't mind, underline the word temple of God. Because these three words just jump out to me, which I have not seen earlier. Although it is there for thousands of years, you know.
Yes.
Then if you read, and cast out all them that sold and bought in the temple. The second time the word temple is used rather than temple of God. So what is the difference between the two? The two is, the temple is temple of God.
Yes.
The Lord came into the temple of God. That was designed by God.
Right.
Called by God, made by God.
Right.
And that temple of God should be the house of prayer.
Yes.
But when he entered into what is supposed to be the temple of God, he found there commercial activities. When he found commercial activities, it is no more temple of God, it's just temple.
Temple.
The God factor is now out. God is no more there in such activities. Though from external, the activities are going on. Sacrificing is going on, offering of incense is going on, everything is going on, all activities are going on. But God is not there. It's just a temple, just a building, just a ministry,
yes,
just a pastor, just an evangelist, just a teacher, just all these activities are going on. But the of God is not there. And the of God is ministry unto God.
Unto God, yes.
What do you think?
Well, Sadhuji,
looking at your face, I see that something is brewing there, no?
Well, when you were talking about the activities going on and God is not there, I am reminded of a small story.
Oh, Indians are great storytellers, you know?
Yes. May I share that with you?
Certainly, Pastor Ji.
It's kind of a funny story, but yet it comes right to the point of what we just read.
Okay.
In this story that I read, it says there was a church. Activities were going on.
Okay.
Very, very nice, fancy church. One Sunday morning, a man from the street, dressed in just very ordinary clothes. He didn't have a shirt on, but he had like a pair of pants on that he had belts on, where, you know, they wear in U.S. and other areas were there. So he came and sat down didn't have shoes, sat down in the church to hear, you know, what the word was being preached. And he intently listened to the word. But the people around there, they didn't like the way this man was dressed. So after the service was over, some of the leadership went to the pastor. They said, "Pastor, this gentleman has come. Would you please talk to him and tell him how to dress when you come next time to the church?"
Okay.
So the pastor said, "Okay, I'll go talk to him." So he greeted the man who was there, and he said to him, this man was around 20, 25 years old. So he said, "Young man, I'm so happy you came to the church today. How did you like the message?" He said, "Pastor, the message was wonderful. You said a few things that I needed to hear. I will be back next Sunday to hear what more God wants me to hear." So he said, "Son, I'm very happy that you would do that. Do me a favor. When you come next time, please ask God how to dress." He said, "Okay, Pastor, I will do that.
How was he dressed in that church?
Everybody else was dressed in suits and very nice gowns and everything else. But he was the only one with no shoes.
A pair of overalls.
With no shirt.
Okay.
Just overalls. So,
like a farmer, no?
Like a farmer with no shirt.
Okay.
So he said, "Pastor, yes." He was a very obedient young man, you know. He said, "Yes, Pastor, I promise you I will ask God." So next Sunday came. The boy showed up the same way.
Okay.
Listened to the message very intently. But the leadership got upset.
Okay.
They thought the pastor is not obeying them. So they went to the pastor and said, "Pastor, we ask you to talk to him. If you're not going to do that, we're going to ask him not to come." Pastor said, no, let me talk to him. He went back again and greeted the young man and said, "Okay." The young man said, "Yes, I enjoyed your message." He says, "I will be back next Sunday." So the pastor said again, "Please ask God how to get dressed." He said, "Okay, Pastor, I will." Following Sunday, he came the same way. Now the leadership is ready to fire the pastor.
Whoa. Okay.
And the pastor is preaching. He can see them, you know. So he said, "Now I have to be really hard with this boy." So after the message, he goes to the boy again. He says, "Young man, I know you enjoyed the message. You're coming. I asked you to do one thing. Did you ask God?" He says, "Pastor, I've been asking him from the first day that you told me to ask him." "Then what is God telling you?" He says, "Pastor, the Lord is telling me, how can I tell you how to dress when I've never even been there?"
Never been in the church.
Never been in the church. He said, "How can I tell you how to dress? Because I have never been there to see what is going on in the church to tell you how to dress." So it goes to the scripture. We said, no, activities are going on, but we are so involved with what we are doing that we have lost the concern whether God is in our midst or He's not.
Hearing your story, I feel in my heart, same scenario. Is the Lord truly in our midst, in each individual's life?
That is a question that we've got to really ponder on. See, Paul said in the New Testament, God wrote, God does not live in temples made by Him. Right? So He lives in us. We are the temple of God today, right? So the question that you asked me, is God in our midst? The question each person needs to answer, is God in me? Are the activities of my heart, are the activities of my temple pleasing enough for the Lord to be in there?
Just like you said earlier in your story, the church, the Lord is not in the midst. And our body is a temple of God. So it's a church. So with all the good activities going on there, but the Lord was not there. So in our life, the temple, so is the Lord there? Is He there in the midst of what is going on?
Yes.
So for the Lord to come into the temple, firstly it must be a house of prayer.
Yes.
But it is a den of thieves.
Yes.
Which if you look from that, let's take this scripture and put on as a spectacle.
Yes.
You put on the spectacle, you look around. Don't have to look at anybody.
No.
Just look, stand in the mirror and look at our own lives.
Yes.
Because all the time we are good at looking at others, you know. And we forgot to look at ourselves.
Right.
So let's stand in the mirror. Look at the mirror with this spectacle. We can see our own life. So what is inside? Full of commercialism? Commercial activities, we're running here, running there, running here, running here, do this, do that. But the incense is not rising up.
Yes.
Relationship.
Yes.
Between the Lord and us. Mm-hmm. Why are you giving the cheeky smile?
No, I'm just saying that that's true. Because yes. I'm just thinking
how...
Something
is going on in your mind.
No, how we are able to take the scenarios from the scriptures and apply to our life. I like what you just said, Sadhuji. We're looking around. We're looking at, you know, the scripture that says that my house lays in waste. Granted, we talk about the temple as the church, but we as His temple lay waste.
You know, when the Lord God called the prophet Moses and told him to build the sanctuary, and then the Lord gave him the rules and guidelines, how temple services should be conducted, and also about the duties of the priests. The Lord laid down guidelines. And He said, number one duty of the priest, they will minister unto me in the priest's office. Then they'll minister unto the people. So the number one activity is within the holy place.
Yes.
The activities within the holy place has got nothing to do with the outside crowd.
Right.
It is lighting the lamp, pouring oil, making sure the lamp is burning continuously day and night. Then every 7 days, change the bread, and then the incense also continually rising up. All these three activities is unto God.
Yes.
Not unto men. These are daily ongoing activity, day and night. The sacrifices stop at evening time, no?
Right.
Night time, no sacrifices. Office closed. But activity inside here goes on daily.
Yeah.
So what are we doing? Are we sacrificing, running here, running there, going to work, coming to work, tending to our children, doing housework, running errands, and then taking a vacation for ourselves? It's that I-centered activity.
Yes.
No more God-centered activity.
Yes.
So, if we live such a life, then the Lord looks at, who are you? I don't know who you are.
Yes.
I don't know that person. Right?
That's correct.
You know, I've heard some people say, no? When a young man proposes to marry a girl, say, I don't know you. How am I going to marry you? Am I right?
Right.
I don't know you. You know, when some Westerners, they hear about Indian marriage customs, they said, how can you marry a person that you don't know? They said, I've answered, that's the fun of it. You start loving that person.
Yes.
Not before you pick and choose. You don't know the person, start loving them. Good, bad or ugly. So the cliche is, how can you marry someone that you don't know? You don't know them. First you get to know them. So likewise, if we are not spending time with each other, fellowshipping, getting to know each other, you cannot say you know me.
Right.
Neither can I say I know you.
Right.
But say, of course I know Pastor, Reverend, are you doctor?
No.
Okay. Why not?
No, I don't.
Okay. Reverend Lou Lutra, Minister of a Dwelling Place Ministries, that I know. Husband wife, Cynthia Lutra, father of three children. What most people don't know is you are also a grandfather.
Yes.
Yes. That most people don't know.
Don't know.
That you have not a little grandchild, big
grandchild.
20-year-old grandson.
Yes.
So, externally, that's what people know.
Right.
But Once we get closer and we fellowship, we talk, we dish, we that shit, I know him.
Yes.
I know him.
Yes.
In the same manner, for our body, which was originally meant to be the temple of God, instead of being the temple of God, if it's a temple of God, then these three activities must be there.
Right.
The candlestick, praying in the spirit.
Yes.
Showbread, meditation of the word of God.
Yes.
And incense, opening our heart and pouring out before the Lord. Mm-hmm. These three activities must be there. Then only we can enter into the holies. Mm. To know him who dwells within the cherubim.
Yes.
So that he can talk to us and we can talk to him.
Yes.
Only then, no, just like the veil being parting or parted, that our spiritual eyes will be opened. Mm-hmm. To see and to hear. Mm-hmm. You know, something amazing is God is a spirit. Mm-hmm. When the high priest enters into the most holy place once a year, the first thing he sees is the Shekinah glory above the mercy seat. Mm-hmm. The Shekinah glory is the cloud of glory.
Right.
And it is spiritual thing.
Yes.
Which is manifesting physically there. Mm-hmm. So he needs spiritual eyes to see.
Yes.
Then he hears the voice of God talking to him from between the cherubim. Mm-hmm. So he needs spiritual ears.
Yes.
So that will only happen after he passed through the veil.
That's right.
So the veil will part. Spiritual eyes been opened, spiritual ears been opened, which will only happen. Now, there it says once a year. But if you look at this thing in a larger perspective, when I say larger, you know, are you having a large dinner at home today?
No, probably on the weekend.
Oh. Then how come Cynthia called earlier to say, please remind my husband to come home early because there's a large turkey?
Oh, I think she's preparing.
Yeah, okay,
so surprise.
Actually she told me that. Please don't tell my husband. Just send him home early. So, okay. We'll just pause here at large.
Okay.
Okay? And then tomorrow, please come back.
Okay.
On time.
Yes.
Then we'll talk about this.
Yes. This is an important subject.
Oh, yes.